The last thing Jesus told his disciples to do was to go everywhere and teach everyone to obey everything he asked them to do. But how? How were 11 uneducated and unsophisticated Jewish men supposed to make disciples in all the different cultures and languages of the world? They had no money, no power, no organization, and no leader. And to make matters worse, they were outcasts in their own society and religion. The disciples didn't seem to have anything, and yet they changed everything. What they did have was a life-changing experience with Jesus, a willingness to simply obey, the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh yes, and lots of contacts. What we call today a social network. Here's what happened. Everything started with prayer. Then came the power of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost. After Pentecost, people visiting Jerusalem from faraway places went home and told their friends and family what God had done. And when those people passed on what they had experienced, the good news about Jesus spread like wildfire. Post-Pentecost social networking is how the gospel went viral. That was over 2,000 years ago. So how are we doing today? There is some good news and some not so good news. The good news, the number of Christians is increasing. The not so good news, the percentage of Christians is stuck. So what's the problem? And how can we solve it? The biggest issue seems to be that not all believers in Jesus are actually obedient followers of Jesus. The main job of being a disciple of Jesus is to make more disciples. But not many people are doing that today. In the first century, what created a spiritual revolution was disciples making disciples who made disciples. Dozens became hundreds, hundreds became thousands, and before too long, thousands had multiplied to millions. All because ordinary people simply obeyed what Jesus told them to do and taught those who responded to do the same. We think this is an idea whose time has come again. We call it disciple-making movements, or DMM for short. It's a movement because it can multiply naturally. So how do you start a disciple-making movement? It's actually very simple. The engine is what we call a discovery Bible study. Here's how a discovery Bible study works. As God reveals a leader within a community, a disciple-making coach helps them to form a group from among their friends and family. The group starts a process of direct interaction with God's Word. The format is simple. What does the passage say? What does it mean? What will I do in response? And finally, who can I tell so another group can start? Personal discovery, immediate obedience, and consistent replication are the launching pad for new movements. Every individual has a unique circle of influence. No two are exactly alike, but everybody's circle overlaps with many others. The intersection points are where movements take off. No matter what country, language, or culture, people share what is important to them with those they care about. Normally, when we dream about the future, we want to leave behind the old and embrace the new. But perhaps as we reimagine how to complete the Great Commission, we need to go back to how it all began. The early followers of Jesus turned the world upside down through simple obedience and natural networking. We're watching the same thing happen today. Since March 2005, City Team has documented over 1 million new followers of Jesus who joined the mosaic of nations, tribes, and tongues around the throne through our DMM process. That's a lot of disciples. Over 400,000 of these are Muslims who fell in love with Jesus. We believe that this is just the start of what God wants to do through unleashing the power of disciple-making movements. As it was in the beginning, it will be until the end. Ordinary people multiplying disciples in their natural networks is God's plan to complete the Great Commission. Disciple-making movements, an idea whose time has come again.